really excited to be back. And thank you for those who were here last week who are back for more. We did sort of break up the learning into three sections. So we have three 45-minute sections, kind of fast and furious. So I do apologize if I move I quickly is my default, but please do stop me or slow me down if I go too quickly and I lose you. It's much more important that we, learn in the moment rather than me getting to the end of the presentation. Speaking of which, you will all receive a copy of this presentation. I'm sending it to Teresa and she's forwarding it to everyone who registered for the session. So you can also go back and look at it on your own time. And if you would like to join, I do encourage you to please join the Nearpod. I have embedded several interactive activities just so you can model the strategies from the student perspective. And so I think that's really valuable. I'm sort of in the teacher's chair today where you normally are, and we've reversed it. You're my students in the sense that you're going to be modeling some of these interactive activities. So I'd love if you could please log in, and that way you can see all of the draw it's and the collaborate boards and all the things that are part of this interactive presentation. So to do that, you'll see the instructions are right here. It asks you to go to join.nearpod.com. So I'm just showing my screen. I'm going to open up another tab. You can also open another browser or if you have a separate screen. And at the top, I'm just going to type join.nearpod.com. And it's going to pull up a very simple screen where it's asking me for a code. And that code is always in the upper left-hand corner. I'm going to pop it out so it's bigger, but you'll see it's FAQ, which is a nice, easy one to remember today. FAQ I8. That's kind of funny. It makes me think of an actual sentence. I'm going to go back to my little Nearpod, and I can easily remember that one. FAQ I8. I love that. And then click join. And it is going to ask me for my name, my nickname. I'm just going to put Tracy here. And I love to sometimes see the organization in the nickname category, if you don't mind putting that, so I can kind of see where you guys are from. So that when we are in the session, I will see, your names and your organizations. And I'll probably make them anonymous just so you can feel comfortable sharing your ideas. But when I go back and look, I can see where you are from. So now I'm in the student view. It's a little different from the presenter view because you have tools as a student that I do not have as a presenter. You have note-taking tools. So up here in the right-hand corner, if you click on that, it'll open up options for you to send your notes to yourself. And at the bottom here is where you can actually make your notes. So I've asked for Nearpod to give us these kind of great tools as the presenter, but you as the students do have those tools. And of course, if you use Nearpod, this is a free resource. I'm not trying to sell it. It's just a great resource. Your students can take notes on every slide, and sometimes that's really helpful for them as they're trying to keep up with the content. So that is one place we'll be. Thank you. I've got seven people in the Nearpod, so I appreciate you signing in. And then we'll also be at PBS Learning Media. Some of you were with me last week. We spent the whole 45 minutes on PBS Learning Media, just having that recap. We won't be spending much time on how to today. We're just going to jump right into the content. But if you want to open another tab and type in gpb.pbslearningmedia or take that service, it's PBS content, so it is completely free, of course. So all of our PBS content has been free my entire life. It's about as old as I am. And so you'll see that I'm not even signed in, but I can access all of this content, all these videos, these interactive lessons, these games, these galleries. These are all open to me as a teacher, as a student, as a parent. And this is where we get all of our content for our presentations at GPB because they are OERs, open educational resources. We're not a vendor. They don't cost you a cent. So please keep these in mind. Wonderful, wonderful resources. If I pull them all up by clicking on the magnifying glass, you see today we have almost 32,000 games, videos, lesson plans, primary sources, all kinds of good stuff. Right, so I'm going to go ahead. I don't see Teresa, if please jump in if there are any questions in the chat, but I'm going to move pretty quickly otherwise, but I have no problem pausing. So please interrupt me if there's a timely question that comes up. All right, so today, part two, digital media integration strategies. So we did last week, again, we did an introduction to PBS Learning Media. So today we're going to take some of that content that we explored last week, and we are going to apply it and link it to some strategies. Of course, all the content we're exploring is STEAM and STEM. So we do have that theme for our STEM Explorers Guild. But we're now going to be connecting it with strategies that really are applicable for any resource. So whether or not you teach just science, technology, engineering, math, or whether you're also social studies and English, depending on your, if you're an elementary teacher, of course, these strategies can really be used across the board, regardless of the content area. I also feel they can be used for any age group. So I know that we have folks who signed up from elementary all the way through middle. And so I did try and pick content that was kind of in the middle for everyone, but these strategies can be tweaked for any age group. They can be made a little bit more complex for older kids, and they can be simplified for younger kids. So keep that in mind as you are looking at these strategies, ways that you might tweak them for your particular classroom. If you have any questions or ideas, would love to hear them in the chat, you know, ways that you've used this strategy or ideas for using it, would love to hear from you. So our goal is today, again, to help you expand your knowledge of all the STEAM content we have at GPB and PBS Learning Media, and also give you those ideas for pairing the content with some really meaningful and engaging teaching strategies that you can use over and over again. So these strategies are not like a one and done. They're strategies you can use on a regular basis so that your kids can not only learn the content, but also work on those soft skills that are part of the teaching strategies. And we'll talk about them a little bit too. So our flight plan, as I like to say, is first of all, we're just going to do a very quick recap of PBS Learning Media for those who are joining us new this week. We are going to jump then right into the teaching strategies. I've paired them under three different categories. So starting simply, diving deeper, and then some awesome acronyms. We'll wrap up with that, and then we'll have some final Q&A. Would love to hear one thing that you got out of the session or that we could do to support you, and then we'll talk a little bit about next week, what's coming up. So here again, for those who were with me last week, we're back at PBS Learning Media. For those who are new, this may be new to you. Again, you just go to gpb.pbslearningmedia.org. You will know that you're there by this little button in the left-hand corner. That's the home button. So no matter how deep you are into the content, you can always click that to come home. Again, I'm not signed in here, but I can still access all the content. And you'll see if I do like simple searches for STEM, for instance, it does pull up quite a lot of STEM resources. Now, some of these are going to be the stem of a plant, but you'll see the very first ones that come up are about STEM occupations, STEM projects and activities, STEM careers, all different ages. Here's Curious George STEM, but then you also have, you know, STEM for older children like these career labs or STEM in 30. So again, this says there are more than 1,000 resources just about STEM. And of course, you can also search for up in the subject here, you can go into science and mathematics, as well as engineering and technology. So you can also search for the content within the individual STE and M, but that one search for just the word STEM pulls up a lot of keywords. Research by subject, by standards. If you're logged in, you can see those Georgia Standards of Excellence. You just have to log in, create a free account as a Georgia teacher, and you'll have access to those. You'll notice that I am in the teacher view. There is, if I click over to the student view, my students also have a free account that they can sign in for or sign up for. You can link them to a class or an assignment here, but you'll see their view is a little bit different. It's simpler, but they can see their assignments, their classes. If you do link to them, they can favorite their own content. They can do keyword searches. If I pull up everything for them, they have 22,000 results. So they just don't have the teacher resources, but they have everything else. And you can see on the left, all the different types of resources, the languages that are available, some of the accessibility features, all of this is also there for your students. You can flip back and forth. I'm going to go back to the teacher view at the bottom here. So you can flip back and forth between teacher and student as well, if you'd like to see the view your students are getting. I did want to highlight a couple of collections today because our theme, and again, we are studying so many different things in class. I chose one theme that I thought might help just kind of keep us focused. And so the theme I chose today is structures, infrastructure. Seemed to do well for a STEM theme because it does incorporate, of course, science, technology, engineering, and math when you're doing infrastructure. And so there are a couple of collections I wanted to highlight. This one is from KQED Science, and it is a collection of structures. It has 11 videos and one interactive for all different grades. You'll see they're short videos. This is about building bridges, only less than 2 minutes. This is an actual game or interactive, a bridge challenge that your kids can go in and play. You'll see there are some more videos here. And all of these resources have support materials. So if you click on that little page, little icon at the bottom, it says this particular video, a very short video, but it has two support materials. So if I click on it, I'll see not only can I show this video to my students, I can download it, I can favorite it. But over here, there's a background essay for me to give me ideas for how to present the video. And there's also some discussion questions for my students. And so these are resources that come with the content that might help you so you don't have to reinvent the wheel. Another collection I wanted to highlight, we did talk about this last week as one of the hands-on collections. So you'll see there are lots of activities that you can do in this collection from Design Squad Nation. That has 13 videos and the documents, six of them are actually labs. So they're hands-on labs with materials and procedures and all of that for K through eight. And I again highlighted the section on structures. This is a subtopic under Design Squad Nation. And you'll see that there are all kinds of things here about building trusses and tents and balancing and welding and cementing and kinetic sculptures and high rises. So again, lots of really great, a paper table. I did this with my kids where we created this amazing structure out of paper. They were flabbergasted by the strength of the paper, how we were just able to rip it when we were done, but it held so much weight. So very interesting activities you can do with your kids with very accessible, inexpensive in materials like a newspaper. So this is, again, a great collection you might want to keep in mind if you're looking for some STEM content that would be useful for you. So I'm going to pause for 1 second there. Again, moving very quickly, but I didn't want to spend too much time on PBS Learning Media since we did spend all of our time last week there. If there are any questions about PBS Learning Media, specific ones, I'd be happy to address those for you or review. Or if you've had time from last week to go in and play around, if you saw something that was a little confusing, please take the moment here to ask me about PBS Learning Media navigation or content. Happy to respond. And of course, if you were here last week and you went in and explored and found something cool you'd like to share, please do throw that in the chat as well, because of course, we're here to learn from each other. And so you may have found something that other participants here today could really benefit from. All right, I'm going to move along into the meat of the presentation. Here we're going into the strategy. It's called two strategies to highlight. These I'm sure you've heard of. And a lot of times I know that I, as a teacher, sometimes dismiss strategies that seem very, very simple. And it's when you apply them in the classroom environment that you see that although they seem very simple, they really have profound results. So I wanted to highlight these two. One's called See No Wonder. The other's called See Think Me We. And the See No Wonder is really a great pre-assessment activity where you introduce the topic. Today, the topic that we're going to be watching a video about is called structural engineering. And so you might want to ask your kids, you know, what do you already know about structural engineering? What do you think structural engineers do? How do you think that this particular skill or career contributes to the community around us? You know, looking around you, how do you think structural engineers may have been involved in our school or in the, you know, the roads or our neighborhoods? And then, do you have any questions about structural engineering or engineering in general or structures that you want to ask before we go into the video? So sometimes that see no wonder is a really good place to start. And what the reason that I'm really focusing on strategies today is because even though PBS Learning Media has so many lesson plans and interactives and really hands-on grab and go resources, so that again, you have very little preparation that you have to do. The content is already there and ready to go. But every once in a while, you'll find a video or some resource that's just so engaging and so powerful that you want to use it, and it may not come with a lesson plan or with some other kind of resources. And so these strategies are so powerful for taking that meaningful video, pairing it with a meaningful strategy, and having again ready to go in your classroom. So these are just some strategies to keep in your toolbox and, you know, try in different circumstances. And if they work, if they resonate with your kids, you can use them over and over again. So of course, see no wonder and see thank me we really helps your kids with so many soft skills. It helps them, of course, with summarizing. So in terms of know, what do you already know about the topic, or what do you think about the video you've just watched? That helps them to summarize their knowledge. That's an important soft skill. Also, it helps them to identify key ideas and details from the content. So that's that see, what did you see? What information did you garner from watching this? So that's the, again, the observation skills. What do you wonder? That's that soft skill of questioning that our kids really need, especially in science and engineering and technology, where they're constantly questioning, you know, how can I improve this? How can I solve this problem? So these soft skills are so important, and the more they practice them through these strategies, the stronger they get in the soft skills as they're learning the content. So we're going to watch a video, a very short video, again, about structural engineering. And as we watch this, please be thinking about the see, think, me, we. So what do you notice from the video? What did you learn? What are some facts that you gleaned from this content? What did you think about it? You know, what is something that really popped into your mind as you were watching the video? How did it connect to you personally? Maybe there's some experience that you've had that really connects to the content that no other person has had, that's unique to you, but that can, of course, expand, you know, the understanding of your classmates, your colleagues. And then the we, how do you think this topic can contribute to the big picture of our communities, our civic engagement, you know, some of the challenges that we have today in our cultures and our environments. So keep these in mind, please, as you're watching the video, the see, think, me, we, because we will be sharing those afterwards. This video is from the collection called Quest. And again, it is very short. It's a minute and 41 seconds. So I chose short videos because our time together is so limited. There are plenty of them. But you'll see you can download this video if you want to save it to your computer, if you have trouble with Wi-Fi. There is a transcript available. So that's really great for, you know, language learners and different literacy levels and differentiation. They do have that standard connection with the Georgia Standards of Excellence here. You can favorite it. You can share it in an email or in Facebook or in any of the social media you use with your kids. You can build a lesson around it with a rubric or some questions you can embed. If you share this link, your kids will see only the student view, so they won't have access to this, you know, support materials for teachers, or you can link it to your Google Classroom. And again, this content tools, yes, yeah. So here is the content from, I just have the video, so we're gonna play it. Again, less than 2 minutes, here we go.
Ever wonder how tall buildings can withstand windy days? Or why bridges don't collapse when large trucks drive over them? Well, the answer is structural engineering. Structural engineers use physics and math to design and analyze the sturdiness of structures. You know, things like bridges, buildings, concert stages, and even roller coasters. Don't get me wrong. Designing any one of these things can involve multiple types of engineering, but it's structural engineering that's responsible for making sure that that structure won't collapse or fall over. You see, a structure must be able to handle the forces or loads that it's likely to experience. Take a skyscraper, for example. It not only has to support itself, but also all the people and furniture inside the building, and then external factors like wind, snow, or an earthquake. The materials and geometry that make up a structure influence how it may respond to those forces. Different materials have different properties like strength, weight, and flammability that can influence a structure's sturdiness. For example, steel is generally stronger and weighs more than wood, and different geometric shapes work better for different purposes. For example, a square or rectangular base can typically hold more weight than a triangular base. So structural engineers perform calculations to determine the best materials and shapes to use in order to build a sturdy structure. So the next time you find yourself on top of a roller coaster, you can thank structural engineers for doing their part to make sure it's nice and sturdy.
So again, such a short video, but there's so much content in there, so many talking points that pop up from that. So I want to give you all a moment to go into the Nearpod. So if you are watching me on the teacher view, go ahead and move over to your student tab, and you'll see that there's access to a Padlet there. And I would love for you to go into this Padlet. This is, most teachers are familiar with this resource. It is a free sort of collaborate board for teachers. So if you could go in, I've created a 4-column Padlet so that we can comment on the see, think, me, and we. And if you could add some thoughts that you have from watching that video. I'm gonna be doing the same. Like one of the things that, you know, I love from this, one of the things I think is I would love to take this as an introduction to an activity. There are so many wonderful activities where you can take paper and turn them into different shapes. And so you can have different groups try different shapes, like a cylindrical base, a triangular base, a square base, a rectangular base, and they can build structures and see which ones are the strongest. And so it talked about that in the video, how, you know, a square or a rectangle is stronger than a triangle. Let's see. So what did you see? I saw a comparison of building materials and their properties. So again, that's wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. And of course, that's perfect for that science component as we analyze, you know, the physical, the atomic structure of different materials, how that can go right deep into the science. Let's see, formulas and geometric shapes. Thank you for pointing that out. So we've got the math in there, of course. We can go straight into those math connections. The trade-off costs of weight and performance, absolutely. Again, so we're talking about problem solving and so it's engineering and technology. Let's see, vocabulary words, right? There were six different types of engineering mentioned, and we'll talk about careers later in this. But I know that growing up when I was in school, I didn't know there were so many different kinds of engineers. I didn't know about structural engineers, for instance. A lot of kids, as they're thinking about what they want to be, it's just really useful for them to know that you can be a civil engineer or a mechanical engineer or a structural engineer, an organizational engineer, and what those different careers entail. Let's see. Thank you. Shapes, of course. So thank you for sharing that. And you can see how a Padlet, again, this free resource, can be very useful for kids if you have one-to-one technology, or even you can recreate a Padlet, of course, in your classroom with sticky notes and whiteboards, and kids can go and fill out the See, Think, We, Me, or you can have a group with a graphic organizer with 4 columns or one of the thing, one group can do city. One group could do things, very simple strategy, and use it to really help your kids get into the content. What factors can affect structures like earthquakes? Absolutely. And this is such a great instructional hook. You know, when they start talking about earthquakes and you saw that little stick figure shaking, then of course, you know that the kids are like, oh, earthquakes, you know, that's where it gets kind of exciting. And so, I mean, here in Georgia, we don't have a lot of earthquakes. And so it doesn't have the emotional intensity that it may have on the West Coast, of course. So it's a great tool for teaching, because earthquakes can really be used as a topic that doesn't have as much emotional connotations, but is such a intriguing subject. How the structures are affected by different forces. Absolutely. So it's talking about snow and wind and all the people. Sometimes we don't think about, you know, buildings are full of things. So you build this beautiful building and then we fill it up with stuff. And the engineers have to think about that too, like all the extra weight from the stuff that we put in our buildings. So thank you so much for these great comments. Really appreciate that. All right, so we're gonna move on. Again, this is what we just did for the strategy. See, think, me, we, what did you notice? What, share your just very basic observations. And that again for kids is to summarize and identify key ideas and details. The think is really that personal connection. What did you get out of it? What knowledge did you gain? How did it connect to you personally? And then of course, we always want our kids to be thinking about the real world connections. You know, this is not just information in a vacuum. How does this knowledge really impact, you know, our connection with the world around us? And so it's always important to have that we, I think, in our strategies. Here's another great tool that I did want to share with you. It's called Scrumbler. And very, very simple. So I went ahead and made a Scrumbler board, and you can see again, there's see, think, we, me here. There's little stickies down here at the bottom. You click on those and you can drag them into, this can even change colors here. You can drag them into the different columns. And so it is just another way that you can get your kids to go into a virtual space. And if you're interacting that way, and have them again add their thoughts here in a collaborate board. So if you didn't want to use Padlet or wanted to mix things up again a bit, there's the Scrumbler board, which I think is also a fun resource. Very, very simple again with just these colored sticky notes. All right, so the next strategy I wanted to share with you guys, or the next section, is about diving deeper. So we kind of started with just a very simple strategies to get kids kind of into the whole thought process and the analysis process. Now we want to go deeper into the content. And so these two strategies are a little bit more complex. So the AEIOU, if you've been to a GPB or Discovery Education presentation, you've heard, I'm sure, about this strategy where the A stands for an adjective. Yes, yeah, I heard Margaret saying absolutely. So the A stands for like an adjective to describe the content, something that you got from the content, the E is the emotion, the I is something interesting you learned, the O is your opinion about it. So again, that personal connection, and the U is an a question, or what do you wonder? This thinking hats is another similar strategy where, again, each hat has a different way to approach the content. And these both work really well with groups where each group can have just one letter or one hat. Or if your kids really are good at this analysis process, give them the whole, all five of them. So the five AEIOU or the five thinking hats, and let them approach the content from all different ways and really, again, increase their depth of knowledge and their analysis skills. So we're going to be working on the thinking hat strategy for this section, just because AEIOU is something I do use a lot. But if you have questions about that, absolutely, please do reach out. I'm happy to share more information about that. But we're going to do the five thinking hats. The first one is facts. So I'm going to share another short video with you that has a connection to structure and infrastructure and engineering and all the math and science that goes into that. So the first hat is facts. What did you learn about this project? The second hat is feelings. You know, what kind of feelings are you about this? Are you excited about it? Are you doubtful about it? Just what about this? What are some challenges of the project? Just learning about it. What do you see, like some of the challenges that might arise? But what are some of the opportunities? You know, maybe this particular technology, it's new, it might be greener, it might have some benefits that we are not used to. So keep that in mind if you have this hat, what are some of the opportunities from this project? And then again, the connections, how can we apply what we've learned from this content into our school environment, our home environment, into our future selves? How can we use this content to connect to the real world? So this particular video, again, very short, 2 minutes and 17 seconds. It is from Nova, which is, of course, a PBS series. One of our favorites. I think we've grown up with Nova, and they have such wonderful content. This particular one is just an excerpt from a larger resource. You can find the credits here. It tells you where the resource is from. So this particular one is from Nova Engineering Ground Zero, and it's an excerpt called Walls of Glass. And you'll see that it comes in English and in Spanish. So many of the resources do come in more than one language, and this particular one is English and Spanish. It also has closed captioning in this one. You can download it again. It has the standards alignments. And just like I mentioned before, you can favorite it or share it in various ways. The student materials are here, more discussion questions. And this one actually has a worksheet with it. The last one just had the discussion questions, but this comes with this great worksheet, just as a graphic organizer for the kids to be organizing their thoughts. So some questions in there maybe you could use as you are designing your assessments around this video. So again, and we're going to watch this video. It looks like we just have it in this particular view. So I'm just going to play it here directly from the Nearpod, 2 minutes and 17 seconds. So enjoy this one.
The design of One World Trade Center presents an architectural dilemma. How do you build a tower that's startlingly beautiful, but also strong and safe? The answer? Glass. The walls of the building will be made of floor-to-ceiling panes of glass, a design called a curtain wall. But this is no ordinary curtain wall. It will use 12,000 glass panels and aluminum casings. The glass alone will weigh 15 million pounds. Each panel will have to bear about 6,000 pounds of pressure, essentially the weight of two cars. And the panes will be huge, reaching up to 10 by 12 feet. Glass may seem like a weak building material, but with the right handling, it can be really tough. To strengthen it, each pane of glass is subjected to 1,150 degree heat. The glass is also extensively tested to make sure that each panel is the right thickness and strength for where it will sit on the building. Also, when it comes to safety, One World Trade Center's curtain wall has a secret weapon, a new type of polyurethane coating. When the coating is sandwiched between two pieces of glass and heated, it helps prevent the wall from shattering, even in the event of a blast from a powerful explosion. The coating also has another purpose, to ensure that the building doesn't get too hot. After all, a tower covered with 700,000 square feet of glass is bound to soak up a lot of heat from the sun. The special coating lets light in, but keeps heat out, lowering lighting and air conditioning costs. It's one of the ways this building will be super green and LEED certified. Of course, in the end, visitors to New York won't see how green or safe or strong this curtain wall is. They'll just see its breathtaking beauty.
So fascinating, isn't it? You 2 minutes. I love the content because it is just both of the videos we've seen are just so engaging and the graphics are beautiful and they're just so short with so much content. So we're going to do this one. This is a Collaborate board. It's another free resource that's embedded in Nearpod. So again, everything I'm sharing with you is free. So we've done Padlets, we've done Scrumblers. Now we're doing a Collaborate board. And this one, I invite you to look at, to begins with A3 facts. You're gonna share down here at the bottom here, type the facts and post them. If your first name starts with F through J, any feelings that you had from watching this video? And of course, we always want our kids to be expressing their feelings. You know, a lot of times in school, we want that to be part of the learning process, but they have to feel safe. And so the more we give them the opportunity to express their feelings in an academic setting, the easier it comes for them. So feelings should be part of it as well. If your first name starts with K through O, if you would list some of the challenges that you see in this project, and they did talk about some of the challenges on the video, so maybe you could relist those or just think of other challenges that you came up with. If your first name starts with P through T, opportunities. So they talked about LEED certification and the beauty and the green. So anything like that that you got from it or other opportunities that you see. And then if your name starts with U through Z, your first name U through Z, any connections that you see between this content and then your community and how you could use this information. So thank you, Tyler, for sharing that and opportunity. How can we build buildings with better design choices? Of course, we understand that this particular series is about rebuilding the World Trade Centers. So we know that from that horrible tragedy to our country, there was this opportunity to rebuild the buildings and make them even more beautiful and more environmentally friendly. So, you know, we do as teachers want to make sure our kids understand that sometimes, you know, great sacrifices can lead to great opportunities as well. Thank you, BJ, for a fact. The coding keeps heat out, lets light in. I mean, that's amazing, right? We know that we would just expect that a building like that would just turn into an oven, but no, they figured out a way. These mechanical engineers, right? These who know about materials have figured out a way to fix that problem. So yes, thank you for sharing that. All right, any other things? I don't want to cut anyone off if they're typing. Thank you, Tanya. Looks like we've got a couple of T's, a couple of opportunities. How can we build buildings that are strong but keep them beautiful? Absolutely. And of course, renewable resources as well, right? So we may not use as much wood, which is beautiful. So how can we find resources that are strong and beautiful and that are renewable as well, readily available? So yeah, who knew that glass could be strong. That was something in terms of my feelings. I'm not an F through J, but I did think, is that really true that you can build a building from glass and that it's strong? It can withstand, you know, explosions and earthquakes and weight, but apparently so. So to me, that's just amazing. I'm amazed, it's my feeling, that we can build a building out of glass that's as tall as this new Trade Center. It's pretty incredible. So thank you for sharing those. All right, we've got about 8 minutes left. This next section, I'll probably just skip over this really quickly so we can go to the last one. This is called Muddiest Point and Crystal Clear. And again, this is part of that diving deeper into STEM learning and thinking. Oftentimes we will introduce to our children, especially math and science and technology and engineering. These can be challenging sometimes, you know, in a good way and in a way that really taxes our ability as teachers to make things accessible to all of our children. And so sometimes it's great to start with the muddiest point where you introduce content and then you ask everyone in the class to share with you the muddiest point. So there aren't like, you know, the dummies out there who are like, I don't understand, who feel embarrassed to raise their hand. Everybody has to share what was not quite clear to them. And that can really help you as a teacher to focus on the areas that need a little bit more hand-holding, instructional help. And it also, again, just allows everyone to really think deeply into what they're learning and areas where they may not be as comfortable. And I think kids have a tendency not to do that because they don't want to be judged, you know, or graded because they didn't get it. So if it's part of the classroom environment that everyone is sharing what they don't get, then it makes it much more approachable. And if you want to, you can also introduce the opposite, which is crystal clear. You know, what's really clear? What did you guys totally get from this? You know, what do you really feel like you is so clear to you that you could even teach it to another person? Like you could teach, I could pair you with someone who this may not be crystal clear. So invite students to come up and show the topic and give them that, you know, that leadership opportunity. So muddiest point and crystal clear. The resource I chose for this one, again, we won't have time to watch this, but it is about math. And of course, there's a lot of math involved with structural engineering and infrastructure. This particular one, I just thought was super cute. It's longer than most of the other resources I want to show you today. It's about 5-6 minutes long. It does come in English and in Spanish. And it is about, has a very strong math component. So I'll start it a little bit just so you can kind of see. It's very cheeky, which I love, which I think makes math more accessible when you have sort of a silly, cheeky aspect of it. So I'm gonna play a little bit of it The audio quality is a little bit lower than we're used to because it's an older video, but I do think it's kind of timeless in the way that it approaches this particular subject. So I'm going to play a little bit just so you can see again the type of content that's available in PBS Learning Media. This is in Math at the Core. It says middle school. I taught third, fourth, and fifth grade as well. I think this would be fine certainly for my fifth graders. So play a little bit of this.
And now, a tale of epic proportions. Once upon a time, the king from Kingopolis and the queen from Queentopia fell madly in love and decreed they would marry. "This marriage will finally unite our realms," said the queen.
"Huzzah! Hooray!
Kaloo! Kalay!" said the rejoicing subjects. In order for the couple to make a proper royal procession through both territories, a bridge needed to be built across the river between them.
"But how high to build the bridge?"
said the royal engineers. The king and queen discussed it and agreed that 12 feet high was a noble height for a bridge. They ordered their respective royal engineers to
make it so.
"Oh yes, quite right, make it so." The queen's engineers began building from Queentopia. The king's engineers from Kingopolis, and the plan was to meet in the middle. All was merriment and joy and anticipation, for the king and queen decided that they would marry upon the day of completion. Alas, it was not long before discord was introduced to the land. For as the bridge neared completion, the peoples began to realize that each side of the bridge was not the same height. As is usual in these matters, they began to blame each other.
"What?"
I'm going to pause that. You can go back later and find out what happened, but you can see it's a story. It's going to start introducing more and more math as they try and solve this problem. So again, very STEAM-like, the problem solving. There's a design challenge there. How do we meet this design challenge and solve it? So I hope you enjoy that one. Again, because it does go into the math, it is great for this opportunity for the kids to share the muddiest point, even though it's a story and it's fun, and you may need to watch it a couple of times. There is math in there, and so they may need to go in and of course, figure out and share what is the muddiest point from the math introduced in the story. So in the last bit of time we have, I want to share these last two CG strategies. I call them awesome acronyms for STEAM career exploration. The PMI stands for plus minus interesting. And then the EWNS stands for east, west, north, south. These are the compass points. And so these are great strategies for when you are introducing career opportunities in STEM, which is always a great way to wrap up a unit. So if you have been doing, say, a unit on structure, infrastructure, and you've kind of done that interdisciplinary exploration with the science and the math and the technology and the engineering, it's a great way to wrap it up with a exploration of the different careers. And this particular one may have been construction, or it may have been engineering. It may have been manufacturing. So all different kinds of careers are involved. You can pick several or just one, but it's always great for kids to be able to explore these career questions. So PMI, as I mentioned, stands for plus minus interesting. So if you were to be involved in this career, what's something that would be a plus about working in this job? What's something that would be a minus, a negative? And what's something that would be interesting for you? And of course, there's no right or wrong answer. Some kids are going to find that, you know, working with heavy machinery is a positive. Some kids might find that a negative, a minus, because they're scared of the heavy machinery. Some people might, it's a positive, but, you know, pie or others meaning terrifying. So the PMI again is very personal, but it gives the kids a chance to really explore from their perspective. The compass points is the same kind of thing, but it's a little bit more in depth. So I use that one today. So the compass point stands for E, east, north, west, south. The E is for exciting. What excites you about this career? The W is for worries. What worries you about this career? The N is for need to know. If you were to consider this career, what else do you need to know about it that you didn't get from the content that we just explored? And then after all of this and discussing it with your friends and coming up with your final idea is your stance. So what is your final stance about this career for yourself? Would you like to consider it, maybe do further research, or is this you really feel at this point absolutely not for you and you'd like to explore a different career? So again, just gives your kids that chance to think about it for themselves. So we're going to watch one last video, and this one is on being a civil engineer. It's about 2.5 minutes long, and we're going to be thinking about the compass points, what's exciting about being a civil engineer, what's worrisome about being a civil engineer, what else might you need to know about this job opportunity, and then after all that, do you have a final opinion about whether or not this might be something that you would enjoy? So we're going to play this, and this is our last piece of content before we wrap it up today. So I hope you enjoy this.
Sometimes with engineers, there's a stereotype like, no, you just like to go inside and be an introvert and just read textbooks all day. Definitely not me. I like to talk. I like to hang out with friends. I love basketball. I love sports. Hello, everyone. My name is Alicia Ballard, and I am a structural engineer currently working at San Francisco Public Works. Structural engineers work on all the plans in order to develop structures like bridges, infrastructure, like large buildings, also doing analysis, figuring out if those structures are safe. So here at San Francisco Public Works, I do things like go out on site visits and do bridge inspections. When we go out on a bridge inspection, we're looking at new things that have occurred with that bridge to see if something has occurred and that we need to repair immediately. We take those things seriously for the safety of our community. And then also aside from that, we go out on site facility visits for different projects that we do and just double check dimensions, look at the scope of the work. You have to make sure that you're aware of everything going on and then go back and make sure you design it so it can go through to construction. So one of the things that I really love about being an engineer is being able to help people. Being part of public works means that you are working for the public. So you get a chance to give back to your community. All of the structures that I work on, everything that I inspect is for the people around me. So the first thing that you have to do when you want to become an engineer is go to college. That was my first step. I graduated from San Diego State University with a degree in civil engineering. My advice to students pursuing engineering is definitely find a mentor. Find a mentor while you're in high school, even middle school if you can. I found mentorship in my student organization called MEDSB, National Society of Black Engineers. There were many people that just cared to see me go somewhere. And with that being said, I went to a conference in San Francisco and a recruiter picked me out and I got my opportunity here at San Francisco Public Works.
I just love that video because she gave so many great tips. So again, if you would just very quickly go into the compass points or throw it in the chat since we're pretty much out of time, I'll show you really quickly what it looks like. I have created a graphic organizer. And so for each of the different compass points, so you would just go to the bottom here, click on a box, a text box, and then you can slide it into that particular square. And then you would put what you would be excited about, you know, as an engineer, what you might need to know moving forward, if you wanted to consider that job as a structural engineer, what worries you about it. And then, so that we, that can be addressed. You that Benjamin Mel stands, does structural engineering seem like it might be a possibility for you as a student moving forward? All right, so we are at the end of time. I wanted to recap. We started with just a summary of PBS learning media. Then we went through all different kinds of strategies from simple to deeper to some acronyms about career exploration. Would love to hear some final questions or thoughts. And if you could throw one thing into the chat that you got from this, hopefully maybe a piece of content that you really enjoyed, maybe a strategy you'd like to try, maybe a question that you would like to ask that you didn't get a chance to, anything that you feel that would improve our session here that was kind of missing, would love to hear that. And then next week, we will be actually building a lesson. So part of PBS Learning Media, when you do sign into your free account, there is a lesson builder tool. And so we are going to go into that next week, and we are going to sort of see how to build a lesson and then give you some time to play with that and actually build a lesson that you can share with your kids. So thank you again for sharing this time with us. Looking forward to hearing what you put in the chat. Please do keep in touch. Here's my contact information, my email, my Twitter account. And of course, I am a guest today with the GTRI, Georgia Tech Research Institute. Thank you, Teresa, for having me. And you can, of course, also reach out to them with any questions, and they will pass it along to me. Thank you so much.